So I'm very interested to talk about biliary strictures, something that we all see in our practice, some of us on a fairly regular basis. You know, we often talk about indeterminate biliary strictures, and these are actually quite uncommon. Like, this term comes up a lot, but it's very, very important to remember that most biliary strictures have a clear cause. And the top three causes are really malignancy, malignancy, and malignancy. So despite what I put here on that slide, if you forget everything I say today, and you may, in fact, forget everything I say today, 85% of biliary strictures are malignant, right? So if you see somebody with a stricture without an obvious, clear other cause, it becomes a search for cancer, 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 with things like surgical injury, stone disease, chronic pancreatitis becoming much less common causes of biliary strictures. So again, if you do an ERCP on somebody with a stricture and you pull out these 27 stones, you could be pretty safe in saying that the stricture is probably related to the stones. But again, the question often comes back to, is it cancer, right? So what are we really talking about here? We're talking about cholangiocarcinoma, right? Or pancreatic cancer, the overwhelming cause of the vast majority of malignant biliary strictures, right? If they have cholangiocarcinoma, or if you're worried about cholangiocarcinoma, you're often looking in the setting of PSC, which we'll talk more about in a minute. You'll be checking a CA19-9, recognizing the limits of this test and that it can be elevated in the setting of a variety of benign conditions. And you'll be looking for systemic symptoms that are often highly conserved in these patients, weight loss, anorexia, sometimes low-grade fevers or night sweats. In patients with pancreatic cancer, maybe they have an antecedent history of chronic pancreatitis, not so often though. Much more commonly associated with an elevated CA19-9, the same systemic symptoms you would see in cholangio often. And remember, too, that pancreatic cancer, despite all of our technology in 2017, can defy CT, MRI, EUS, everything. And I've sent one or two people to the OR where we were sure there was malignancy, but we couldn't prove it, and it was found in the explant. So again, if you do an EUS and you see a large hypoechoic pancreatic head mass there, you can see there's a stent in the bile duct. Like, this is a determinate biliary stricture. This is not an indeterminate biliary stricture. We know what this is. This is pancreatic cancer, and there's really not a lot else to say. But again, often it's not so clear. And if you are scratching your head trying to decide if a biliary stricture is malignant or benign, you're going to want to use multiple tools for investigation. And you may end up using every single test on this slide to help decide if the patient does or doesn't have malignancy. Sometimes you may end up using these tests more than once, and sometimes you will do absolutely everything in your power and you will exhaust your resources and you will not get a diagnosis. So I think if we're going to be talking about biliary strictures, really the prototype or classic disease to talk about this is PSC, as we all know, a chronic inflammatory and destructive disease of the liver and the biliary tree. And in my experience, and in most people's experience, it's really the most common cause of indeterminate biliary strictures. And by that I mean a stricture that's really, really hard to decide. Is it benign or is it malignant? Because these patients with PSC, often they exist in sort of a gray zone between benign and malignant disease. PSC, as we know, is strongly associated with cholangiocarcinoma, and unfortunately, even in 2017, most patients with cholangiocarcinoma are diagnosed at a very, very late stage. So the natural history of PSC is PSC, 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 cholangiocarcinoma, death. That's the way it's been for a long time, and we would very much like to change that. We would like to make the natural history of PSC, 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 early cholangiocarcinoma, followed by resection or transplantations. That's kind of one of my goals in life for PSC. It's always important to remember that PSC not only puts you at risk for cholangio, but it also puts you at risk for HCC and gallbladder cancer. And again, when we're looking at these PSC patients, we're often thinking about dominant strictures, and that term has been bantered around in the literature for many, many years, and there is no universally agreed upon definition of a dominant stricture. And I've put a couple of technical terms on this slide to really kind of show you how well-intentioned these were, but really ultimately unhelpful. So my definition that I've tried to promulgate is the idea that a dominant stricture is the cholangiographic finding of a stricture that stands out amongst all others in a patient with PSC, right? This is the janitor diagnosis. The janitor walking past the ERCP room with a mop and a bucket could look at the cholangiogram with no training and say, that's the worst spot, right? And it's pretty straightforward to do when you kind of think about it that way. The good thing is it's very intuitive and you can apply it fast. The downside is it's a little subjective. So again, here is a patient with PSC, and when I look at this or the janitor walking by, boy, that's tight right there. And all the ducts above are dilated. And lo and behold, that was a cholangiocarcinoma. Right, here's another one. This is a really easy one. There's my balloon. Look at how tight this is. The right system's all gone. Left system's all blown out. Also a cholangiocarcinoma. This was a child who presented. This was their initial presentation of their PSC. This is a tight left hepatic stricture that really leapt out at me when I looked at it. Also a cholangiocarcinoma. This patient had lung metastases on the time of diagnosis. And then here's my balloon up high, but you see this blunt shelf-like stricture in this patient who's had almost complete loss of their ducts. And this is actually benign, but it's still the dominant stricture. It still tells you where to focus your attention. So again, when we're thinking about evaluating these patients for tissue acquisition, right, almost everybody's going to do brushings, right? And then we have a couple of other options that we can do. So routine brushings I still use every day, and anytime I see a biliary stricture, you're going to get three results, right? You're going to get positive, great, you got your answer. Negative, maybe your answer. And the ever popular atypical cells, which are, at least the pathologists in Utah absolutely love to write. The good thing about brush cytology is it's cheap, it's easy, it's safe. You can do it on any anticoagulation. They're on Plavix, take a brushing. They're on Xarelto, take a brushing. Like, you're not going to cause a bleed. You can get a tissue sample in any setting. And like I said, cheap, easy, fast, but not always the most helpful test. And again, atypical cells, you get this all the time, especially in PSC. Pathologists are very, very smart. They're very hesitant to call malignancy in PSC because they know that it will set in motion an enormous and almost unstoppable chain of events. And because the inflammation in PSC can muddy the waters to such a great extent, they are very, very reluctant by training and experience to call malignancy in PSC unless they're 100% sure. And you will often find yourselves resampling these patients multiple times. A couple of years ago, Ben Witten, that actually says in press, but it's been out a year or two now. Ben Witten, who's a pathologist at the Huntsman with me, we created this thing called the AB score, the atypical biliary brushing score, and it was a point system of things in patients with indeterminate strictures to help you decide, was it more or less likely to be a malignant stricture? And if you had four or more points, the patient was mathematically very likely to have a stricture. And what's interesting is PSC gets you 2 points. So the PSC plus an atypical biliary brushing is you're mathematically halfway to cancer. So take those atypical brushings very, very seriously. So this brings me to talking about FISH. So FISH stands for fluorescent in situ hybridization. And I'm dismayed by the fact that here we are now about 15 years after FISH sort of underwent introduction to the U.S. Market, and it's still very, very rarely used. I think it's a terrific test that anybody can do. FISH stands for, again, fluorescent in situ hybridization. This was originally developed to test for urothelial cancer and bladder washings or urine samples. And the idea is that basically you can look for changes in the chromosomes of the cells that it tell you that there is more or less likely to be malignant transformation going on. And really what we're most commonly looking for is aneuploidy, right? Non-equal numbers of chromosomes or extra chromosomes or deleted chromosomes. So this is a photo of one cell. This is just one cell, and you can see there are three chromosome markers on there, two reds, two greens, two blues. This is a normal cell on FISH, right? This is a positive FISH study. You can see there's been, this is actually a photo of a handful of cells, but you can see that there's been additions and deletions of chromosomes, right? They're actually counting. It's actually fairly labor intensive. It's a lot of work to prep the slides, and it's a lot of work to read, but it's incredibly helpful. And I send FISH studies on anybody with PSC in a stricture or anybody that I'm worried has cholangiocarcinoma. FISH can detect polysomic cells before other tests, and in one study, 69% of FISH-positive patients with PSC ultimately had cholangiocarcinoma. 69% is not perfect, but it is better than routine brushing alone. And people have looked at polysomies or trisomies or tetrasomies, and these are all strongly associated with the development of malignancy ultimately. Should FISH be used universally along with routine brushings in patients with PSC? I cannot tell you that the data says that absolutely, but I can tell you that in my practice, that's what I do. So what about cholangioscopy, right? This is a technology that's kind of gone from zero to hero, right? When I was a fourth year fellow, I was at Mayo Rochester, and in my fourth year, I did over 800 ERCPs. And in that year, I did two, count them, two cholangioscopies. I think I did seven or eight last week. Like, this is something that we've gone from doing basically never to something that we do all the time. And again, if you're going to be doing this, you got to kind of know what normal looks like. Here's a nice normal bile duct, looks kind of like the lung. And this is, for example, PSC. So this is a tight stricture in PSC. Is that benign? Is that malignant? Hard to know. Very, very tough to know in PSC. And this is something that's a little more obviously malignant with some fungating frond-like lesions in the bile duct. And here we are taking a little biopsy of it. And this was, in fact, a cholangiocarcinoma. So there's good things and there's bad things about cholangioscopy. And I say this as someone who uses this technology very, very frequently. I can tell you that it can be extremely helpful. It'll allow you to take very, very targeted biopsies and brushings, and often what you think is the worst looking area in a stricture based on the cholangiogram is not the worst looking area based on the cholangioscopy. And it's pretty quick. Once you kind of get good at setting this up and your techs get good at it, you can do this whole exam in 15 to 20 minutes. And I think we recently looked at our data from the past 6 months, and our average cholangioscopy is about 12 minutes now. There is a CPT code, so you can get paid. And the biopsies, which are very small, are up to about 82% accurate in the best of studies. And our experience was a little less than that. The downside is it is a capital equipment purchase. You have to go and ask if you can get this thing. There is a learning curve of about 10 to 15 cases that can be very, very frustrating. Despite the fact that now we have digital technology, the images are not always ideal. The appearance of concerning lesions is not always classic. And sometimes, you know, you think you know what a tumor is going to look like, and you see something and you're not really sure, especially if the patient's been previously stented. And our inter-reader reliability with these devices is unfortunately quite poor. Like, if you take a room of experts, and I say this because it's happened and I've been in that room, and you have us watch a video of something that's a stricture in the bile duct, none of us can agree. And the small forceps biopsies that I showed in the video may just be too small, right? There's no pin on that forceps. You get one little bite per pass. It may just be too small to get a diagnosis. But there's value in just looking. And for example, Doug Pluskow and the departed Young Chen did a study many years ago showing that there was about a 75% concordance to your optical diagnosis. Just look in the duct and see if you think it looks malignant. And we actually showed in the AB score, too, that your impression is very, very important. We published a paper a couple years ago looking at our experience in biliary strictures with cholangioscopy in PSC patients, non-PSC patients, and then we lumped them all. And we found that actually the biggest value was deciding exactly where to take brushings and exactly where to take biopsies. And like I said earlier, sometimes it was not 100% concordant with what I thought was going to be the worst area based on the cholangiogram. So what about confocal? I don't mean to be an electron, and by which I say negatively charged, but I'm a little disappointed in confocal technology. Like, we've had this around a long time. We're probably closing in on 10 years on confocal, and it's very, very exciting. It's a probe-based laser technology that illuminates tissue and then deflects fluorescent light back, and you get a reading. I mean, it's so exciting. It's right out of Star Trek. And the studies on this are all very, very encouraging. And whenever there's a study on this, it looks really, really exciting. But here we are 10 years, and it has not penetrated into mainstream practice. And very few places are doing this. And there are still lingering questions about the value of this. Does it obviate the need for biopsies? What's the inter-reader reliability of this technology? So what about EUS? Again, if we're looking at the bile duct, right, if there's a pancreatic mass, you're probably going to find it with EUS. But EUS for cholangiocarcinoma is kind of a different animal, right? It may allow diagnosis by FNA, recognizing that you don't want to biopsy the primary mass. You want to biopsy nodes if you see them. The reason we don't biopsy the primary mass if we think it's a cholangiocarcinoma by EUS is it may exclude the patient from consideration for transplantation. And again, you get a lot of information about the relationship with the tumor, its size, its thickness, its relationship to nearby key vessels. But the downside is this may be technically very difficult. And I consider myself an extremely experienced EUSer. I've been doing high volume EUS for about 15 years now. But I will tell you, it can be very, very tough to do this. And even in the best of hands, you may get a very limited or poor or non-existent view. Recognize, like I said, don't biopsy that primary lesion, although if you do see nodes that are positive, most patients are considered excluded from liver transplantation. So you're safe to go ahead and biopsy nodes. And again, here's a good example of a large, thick-walled mass surrounding the bile duct. You can see there's a plastic stent in there. Here's the portal vein. So this is almost certainly going to be a cholangiocarcinoma. But again, did I biopsy it? No, I did not. So just in conclusion, stricture management, really when we're looking at indeterminate strictures, I think is best focused on PSC as a sort of medical model. And our stricture management continues to evolve. I think any biliary stricture without an obvious or clear cause, your suspicion of cancer should be, like your threshold to suspect cancer should be extremely low. Please do FISH testing. I have no financial stake in saying that, but please do FISH testing. It is fantastically helpful, and a positive FISH is an actionable finding. Now, you may say, oh, my hospital doesn't offer that. Well, every doesn't matter, because you just have to put it in Cytolite or whatever medium you're using for your regular brushings, and you can send it off to Mayo or ARUP or PathCore or one of those companies, and they can run it for you. Recognize that cholangioscopy can provide meaningful information even in the absence of a definitive tissue diagnosis, but it may help you reach a definitive tissue diagnosis. And EUS is extremely helpful in these patients, but FNA is not for everyone. Thank you very much.